Good morning, everybody. I will talk about using BPF iterators to gain insight into Kubernetes. My name is Alban Kriki. I am a principal software engineer at Microsoft, and I joined Microsoft with the acquisition of Kinfrog. I am working on a team focused on Kubernetes and the BPF, and one of the projects we work on is Inspector Gadget. It's a plugin to kubectl that uses eBPF to get insight into Kubernetes. And we've recently made use of BPF iterators to write new gadgets in Inspector Gadget. So in this talk, I will talk about the timeline from classic BPF until today with BPF iterators. We'll explain a bit what it is, what it can do. I will show some demos using the examples in the Linux sources, and what's missing to make it useful for Kubernetes. And then I will show in Inspector Gadget how it works with the gadget collectors. And then I will briefly mention how it interacts with namespaces and how Inspector Gadget enrich the container metadata and how it does filtering. And at the end, I will do another demo and explain what's more, what's next to do with BPF iterators in Inspector Gadget. So BPF is not something new. It started in 1992, where BPF was used for TCP dump with socket capture, packet capture. And then in 2013, there is this new extended BPF, which brings new eBPF maps to interact between the BPF program and the end user space. And there are a lot of new eBPF program types. So it's not longer only about packet capture, but about tracing or security on different, with different methods. And last year, with Linux 5.8, there are new BPF iterators that get into the kernel. And a few months ago, the Go Cilium eBPF library supports BPF iterators. So the last fix we're in to be able to use it properly. So as I mentioned, BPF have a lot of different kind of programs for networking, for tracing, for security. It could be attached to different kernel objects like LSM, TracePlan, kprobe, and so on. And the new one is BPF iterators that could be used to iterate over different kind of kernel objects. For example, we can iterate over every task. That means every thread on the Linux system can be iterated upon to list them, or on TCP sockets, or UDP sockets, and so on. This is an example of BPF iterator to iterate over threads on the Linux system. As you can see, it's a short program, 25 lines of code. And what you can see is line 8 and 9. It declares that it's an iterator to iterate over tasks. And then there is this new BPF helper function called BPF segprintf that will print the output of this BPF program. And this function will be executed for as many times as there are processes or threads on the system. And it can print one line, it will print one line for each thread. Okay, so now it's time for a demo. Let's see in the terminal. Here you can see I am in the Linux sources. And we will first go to the location where all the useful examples are for BPF programs. So in tools, testing, self-test BPF. Here you can see there is a BPF program. I will look at all the iters, all the files called BPF iter. That's all the example you can see. And I compile them. So one of them I will start with BPF iter task.o. This is the BPF program I showed you before to iterate over tasks. So now I can load this BPF program using BPF tool. And I will load it and pin it on the BPF file system. So I take as input BPF iter task .ru, and I will attach it to this fs.bpf I created a directory for this demo, and I will call it the same way, bpf etf task. So now that should be this file here that you can see here, and I can execute the iterator just by using cat on this file, and it will execute the BPF program as many times as there are threads, print one line for each of them, and here it prints the process ID and the thread ID for everything on the system. Okay, so that's useful already, but then I will show you how I can add more data to this. So I created a copy of these programs, so in BPF iter task, I created a copy called kubecon, and here I just added the kubecon line, and I did two fields, common for the command line, and mon namespace to print the mon namespace ID. And when I attach this, I will be able to execute it the same way. So I will use BPF tool in the same way, but I will take my copy. And then I can execute this in the same way. So now I could add any data I could find from the kernel when it's in a task structure. I print the command line on the mon namespace ID. From this, I will show you how it's different from the classic ps command. So ps can either print the process and the additional information, but is done by looking at different files in slash proc, and is done in a less efficient way because it needs to open a lot of files in slash proc. And actually, if we count the system calls to run this ps command, there are more than 5,000 of them here. And if I compare that with just using the BPF iterator, you just need to open the BPF iterator and read from that, and that's a lot less system calls. Okay, now I will show another iterator on TCP sockets. So same as before, I use BPF tool to attach it on the BPF file system, and then the cat command to run it here. Here you can see it prints one line for each TCP socket, and the IPs are printed in hexadecimal, so that's a bit difficult to read, but here it is. And what I want to show you is when we run the BPF iterator, it matters which namespace we are in. So here I use cat directly on the current network namespace, but if I run it from a different network namespace, you will see the result is different. So I use the mcher command to create a new network namespace. And here you can see the result is empty because it's in this new network namespace, there are no sockets. And in the same way for task. So if I create a new PID namespace and start it, here there is only one process, the process of cat itself. So I can show it here, the cat process. So it really matters which namespace you are in to be able to see the right information. Okay, so let's go back to this to the slides. In summary, I'll show you where to find the example in Linux sources, how to use BPF tool on cat to load and test BPF iterators, how it can list processes, or how we can add more metadata. Here I did the command line, the command name, on the Monet Space ID, how to list TCP socket, and what's the difference in how many system calls are used with the traditional commands. Okay, and if we want to use that in Kubernetes, we have to add more things on top of that. When we use Kubernetes, we care more about high-level constructs like pods, Kubernetes namespace or labels, and we care less about a specific PID or specific IPs. So we want to enrich the data we get so far with additional container metadata to know, for example, which Kubernetes pod does this process belong to, which Kubernetes service does this IP belong to. And next, we want to be able to filter the information, not as before, take all the information on one specific node, but filter by Kubernetes namespace, for example, or labels. So now I will demo this with on the terminal again. So let me start this again. I will show first I have a Kubernetes cluster where I deployed an example application in the SOC shop namespace. So here I will use the kubectl gadget, and then I can call this new gadget called process collector. And here I can specify which namespace I want to look at. And here I can see all the processes which belong to a specific Kubernetes namespace. And I see, for example, in this RabbitMQ pod, there are a certain number of processes. And I can add a filter using labels, like, for example, RabbitMQ. And here it filters only on the expression here. And I can do the same with another collector, the socket collector. And here, demo effect, it doesn't work. And here it is fixed. I run the command again, and here you can see the socket collector return the list of TCP sockets and UDP sockets in the specific Kubernetes namespace. And I can filter by label in the same way. Okay. So here you have seen the process collector and the socket collector gadgets get this information from BPF iterators with a very similar code as the example from the Linux kernel. And then it add more data about the specific Kubernetes namespace, Kubernetes pods, and so on. And it filter the result to only print when the information belongs to the correct containers. About what I explained before with namespaces, it's matter in which namespace you collect information from. So for the process collector, since PID namespaces are hierarchical, we run the BPF iterator only one time in a host PID namespace. And then we fill in the BPF program, we filter the information to only print the output when it's in a container that matters to us. But for the socket collector, since network namespaces are not hierarchical, we need to run the BPF iterator one time for each network namespace we care about. So in practice, one time per pod. Here is an illustration of PID namespace. That's the triangle with the processes in yellow. You can see the inner PID namespace inside a host PID namespace. But network namespaces are not hierarchical, so they're kind of isolated like this. How does container metadata enrichment works? So we use a BPF map, a BPF hash map, where the keys are the Moon namespace ID, And then the value contain the list of strings, like the container ID. That's the 64 hexadecimal digits that we get from, for example, Docker. The Kubernetes namespace and the Kubernetes pod name and container name. This BPF hash map is updated and maintained up to date by the Gadget Tracer Manager. And then when we execute the BPF program of the iterator, this BPF program just reads this map to know how to print the information. Okay, here is, for example, how it's done in this BPF iterator. So first we get the task struct for the thread we want to print. And then we look at the mount namespace ID. And then we look at the map, the containers map. We do a lookup with the key being the mount namespace ID. And then we can print the information we care about. I can also show you this BPF maps, how it works under the hood. So let's go back to the terminal. And now I will execute this command to enter the gadget, pod from Inspector Gadget, and look at the BPF file system. We have this container BPF map, and you can see inside we can dump these things, but first I want to get the namespace, mount namespace ID for the RabbitMQ pod. So here I enter the RabbitMQ pod, I look at the mount namespace ID, and I get this number. And from here, if I want to, I can dump this map here. And I see a list of keys and values. If I look at the keys with this correct mount namespace ID, I will be able to see the different strings here in hexadecimal, with a pod name and container names and so on. Okay, so that was a short insight how it gets the information from there. What's next with BPF iterators? What I would like to have in the two gadgets, the collector gadgets, is to be able to get the stack trace of all the processes, and there are examples how to do that in the Linux kernel. In this example, or to get the list of memory pages, there are an example for that as well, or to get the list of files open on the system for each pod. And then in the socket collector, instead of printing the IP address directly, I would like to resolve them to know if it belongs to a specific Kubernetes pod or service. And then we can write plugins in Headlamp, which is a visualization. It's a Kubernetes web UI, and we can visual, we can see the result of Inspector Gadget plugins. That's what I would like to have implemented. Additionally, I would like Inspector Gadgets to be more modular, so that the data can be available not only as a kubectl plugin, but available on other projects, so that maybe the Go package can be reused directly and make it useful for other projects. Thank you.